Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Doug with Ingenious Technologies, and with me today is Gabe. He's our senior FAE. Hopefully we can answer some questions for you folks after the webinar. But as they come up, I do want to encourage everyone to put questions into the question box. You should see a little tab there, and go ahead and put those in there so you don't forget. And we'll get to as many of those as we can at the end of the presentation here. And if you have any difficulty with anything, also throw them up in there and I'll see if I can't correct it. And we'll check on the questions as we go, but I'll hold off on answering those until the end. But I really want to thank everyone for joining us today. Today we are going to be going through the long-range Duraphone models and how they're used, things like that, and with a little bit of focus on senior care, senior living environment, and a bit of focus on the Duraphone Pro in particular. But we'll touch on a lot of them. So if you have questions on other models and things, don't hesitate to ask those as well. We'll address as best we can. All right, so let's get underway, and hopefully everyone can see the screen that's up and can hear me with a little luck. All right, so for today, we are going to talk about our claim to fame, the markets that we do serve, a overview of our telecom voice offering and how we fit. Like I said, we'll focus a bit stronger on the Duraphone Pro, and we'll go into some case studies and the investment made and some of our difference makers. So there is quite a bit we're going to go through here, but feel free to make notes of questions that you have, and we'll answer those. And I did want to let everyone know that at the end of this presentation, we will go ahead and send out a link to this recording, as well as slide deck if you need it. All right. So our claim to fame is range. That's why people invest with us in our product line, is that we've been a leader in long-range industrial cordless phones for going on 20 years now. And with that, we're put into very demanding environments. And so durability comes up as probably our number two most demanded feature, is that that our handsets and our system itself will perform long range and are durable. It makes sense, for the type of environments that we serve, you want both. You want to have that ability to keep that mobility for your staff, and that they aren't going to come back with a broken phone after every shift. So we do a really, really good job with that. So, and I say that long range is our claim to fame. I want to chit-chat a little bit here with Gabe and go into how the environment affects range and what do we see with our two brands, which are Duraphone and Freestyle, and how those are affected by the environment. So Gabe, maybe you can help us with this slide and understand what the differences are.
Sure. So we have, we have three different environments here. One is retail warehouse, one is hotel assisted living, and then is farm ranch. So normally in the retail warehouse, it's gonna be a single level. Sometimes it's multi-level, mostly it's single level. It's very large and open except for the racks in there. Retail is more open than warehouse. And the warehouse has certain things in the racks. Sometimes it's less intuitive, sometimes more intuitive. But for the most part, in that particular type of environment, for the Duraphone, you'll get up to 250,000 square feet of coverage up to. And for the Freestyle, it's up to 100,000 because it's a lower cost phone and the components in there are not as durable as Duraphone. And for the hotel, it's assisted living. Some assisted living is single story, but mostly hotels are more multi-story. And so you have to worry about the vertical attenuation more than a horizontal. So we have up to 12 floors of coverage for the Duraphone, up to 6 floors for the Freestyle. And then for the farm ranch, it's more open with almost no obstacles in there attenuating, so you could get further range. For the Dura Fund, it could be up to 3,000 acres, and for the Freestyle, it's just up to 10 acres.
Okay. And now this scabe is on a single base, correct?
Yes.
Okay. And are you using, so with that, I assume that you're not using some kind of repeater or you know, multiple bases put up to get this coverage. This is just, if I went in with one base, I would expect coverage similar to this.
Yes, one cell. Like let's say if you were to do Wi-Fi calling, it would, on average, it would take up to 20 access points to cover what we cover with one cell.
Okay. Pretty wild. So again, this is, you know, where we really differentiate ourselves. So instead of having to, you know, wire up a large environment and have, you know, a bunch of access points up there, and I'll try to adjust. I see a note about the sound quality here. So let me see if we can adjust the microphone just a little bit. So hopefully that's a little better. We'll try to speak towards it. With that ability to have one base unit cover this kind of crazy area, and so I'm saving all this time and cost of, you know, putting up a lot of access points and stuff to handle the voice demands. And I'm doing that with a single base. So that really, really is attractive to a lot of users that they can get this coverage and just have that single base and have to just mount one base and get this kind of coverage. And we do have tools to help you with that. And we'll get into that a little bit later, but so stay tuned on that. Oops, didn't like me moving. There we go. Oops. Okay. For our markets, like today, we're going to be focusing a little bit on senior living, assisted living type environments, but we're placed into all sorts of large environments where the employees need that mobility as they go around this environment. So this is from grocery stores to movie theaters, to, of course, assisted living or senior living, to hotels, truck and rental yards, farms and ranches, and self-storage. All sorts of different places our equipment gets placed into. And so if you can just imagine, the right market for us are these environments that are very, very large, and that employees need that mobility to move around while doing their job. So something like a call center where it's a large environment, but everyone's sitting in their cubicle, usually isn't deploying us unless it's for the IT people who are running around. And the same thing with if you have a salesperson who flies around the country, we're not the right fit there either with the fact that that salesperson really needs a cell phone, right? Because they're going well outside the range of a base unit on that, you know, 250,000 square feet coverage. So, but for lots and lots of these markets, we are a really good fit. Okay, and some of the markets, we have numerous banners and flags that are associated with them. That we currently serve and have been serving for years. So I'll just throw that up there a little bit. And because we are looking at assisted living, senior living, I wanted to show a few more that we serve on that. And you can see that all the major ones are up there. And we've been serving each of these for numerous years with our Duraphone product line. So it's really been a good relationship with this market segment. Okay, now we're gonna get into some of the different models, and I'll call out a couple of these things. on these charts, you know, you don't have to race to take notes and stuff. We will make this available to you. So if you want to refer back to that, you can come back to these charts at your leisure. But I'll call out a couple of things that you may want to pay attention to. And then you can get your bearing as you look at these slides. Okay, so with the Duraphone model, you can see that we actually have two models, Duraphone and Freestyle, two brands of models, if you will. The Duraphone model is our flagship line in that it is a bit more durable, longer range, all that than the Freestyle. But let me start by telling you a little bit about the Freestyle. There are two models of Freestyle, Freestyle 1, Freestyle 2. The Freestyle 1, you can see pictured there on the left-hand side, is the one with the keypad. The Freestyle 2 is just below it. With those models, these are single line models, but they will support up to 9 handsets. And they still have crazy range with that, but they are limited to being single line models and they're not multiple base models. So if you were to add a second one of these, they would interfere with each other. So you have to keep that in mind. But it's great if you have maybe a small motel or an assisted living place and you just have one line, you want to have a couple of people be able to answer that. It's a great product for that. The Duraphone line, lots more to consider here. There's a Duraphone PSL and the USL that are single line models that are part of the Duraphone Pro family, which means that you could add that to the Duraphone Pro, or you could add a Duraphone Pro to it, and it will support up to 90 handsets. So the PSL is one line base that can support up to 90 handsets, and the Duraphone Pro is a four line base with that 90 handset, and they can work together so you can add multiple bases, and they're designed not to interfere with each other. And then we also have the Duraphone SIP. This is a voice over IP SIP protocol product. It will support up to 10 handsets and it has 4 talk paths. So you can have 4 concurrent calls at one time on the Duraphone SIP. So that's the overall family that you have there. I do notice that I still have TAP on there. And because we're talking about assisted living, senior living, some of you may be familiar with our TAP product. That has been discontinued, so it is no longer available, but you can certainly have any of these other products be used behind a phone system. It's just that we wouldn't integrate with the nurse call anymore. On this, I'm gonna call out just a couple of columns here. The first column I'd like to call out is the fourth from the left. It's labeled HS/calls. And let me just help define what all that means. So if you looked at the Duraphone Pro and you went over to that fourth column, it says 90/4, then underneath it is parentheses 32. So let me break that down. Those are 90 handsets. So the HS is handsets. And you can have 4 talk paths, 4 calls going on a single base at one time. Now, this one is expandable. It expands up to 8 bases. So 4 ports around that base times 8, 32. So now I can have 32 concurrent calls or dedicated extensions, however you want to look at it, out of those 90 handsets. And one of the questions we get all the time is, well, why if you can have 32 dedicated ports or extensions, would you have 90 handsets? And let me spend just a few seconds here explaining that. The 90 handsets in some environments are shared among on those 32 ports. So you may have a port or an extension behind your phone system dedicated to, and for simplicity, let me take a retail environment, dedicated to the shoe department. And you have 4 people working in the shoe department. Well, a call comes in for shoes, you don't really care who answers that call, just as long as someone in shoes answers it. So four handsets, four people are using those. All their handsets ring and one of them picks up the call. Now, if it turns out to be for somebody in the shoe department specifically, you can transfer that call to that other handset so you can get it to that right person. But they all share that one. So that's why we're having more than just 32 handsets. You can't go to 90. And we do have specialty handsets called the Dura-Walkie. Those are two-way radio handsets, and they don't have telephone access, but they're also part of that family. And we'll talk a little bit more about the walkie a little later. But that's why you see 90 instead of 32 or 4 or something like that. All right. In this chart, Gabe, we have a lot of different things being pointed out here. And maybe you can explain this the flexibility we have with our different products into meeting their demand. If they have, you know, a traditional PBX, how about just a CO line from a phone company or SIP? So what is that talking about?
Sure. So how you get your lines in, so this regular CO is the old school way. Basically, you have a line coming in. You have a PBX, you can have on-site or off-premise PBX, the off-premise one that's hosted in the cloud. And mostly that's handled by a SIP or IP type of you know, command calls on that. So we could tie into any of those systems. We have the SIP that's able to tie into the hosted one, as well as the IP PBX if it's on site. And if you have any analog ports, like a CO or any analog ports coming off of your PBX, we could tie into that too with our analog port as well. So you have many different options of flexibility. You can have an ATA if you want to convert a SIP line to analog, you could do that via ATA.
And a traditional PBX with digital lines would also need an ATA or analog ports to run off that. So lots of flexibility there. On top of that, you know, people start to wonder with our range, are we cellular or something like that, where we'd have a monthly fee and so many minutes or things like that, or data usage. And we don't. All of our phones are just cordless phones. And so there is no annual contract, there is no monthly service fee, there's no data fees, none of that. It's just a cordless phone. So keep that in mind. The other issue is we get hit up with, oh, well, this will put additional demands on my Wi-Fi network. Can you speak to that?
Yes, our phones are 900 megahertz, completely different frequency than what standard Wi-Fi is. And also, we're not under the 802.11 protocol. We're a completely different frequency hopping, different modulation type. We have some encryption included into ours. And those we have chipsets that keep it synced between each other. So it's a proprietary system on a different frequency than Wi-Fi. So long as you don't have the base like inches from an access point or something, You shouldn't have detrimental performance on the Wi-Fi network as well as our phone network.
Okay. And, you know, I got hit up just yesterday, for that matter, on explaining about the Duraphone SIP and the fact that it isn't relying on their Wi-Fi network, their data network. So that one, you know, they knew that, okay, the SIP has to be tied to the network, but it's tied on the wired side. And so by the time the Wi-Fi comes into it, the wireless side comes into it, I'm not putting demands on the Wi-Fi network at all and their access points, because I'm using 900 megahertz on our base to the handset, and that voice is going that way before it reaches the wired network. And so, you know, it's really beneficial not to be added another device, another lots of devices for voice, being added to the Wi-Fi network by going this route.
Yes.
And another chart for you. With this, I'm going to call out a couple of specialty handsets at this point, just to bring those up and make sure that I didn't miss out on them. The one we mentioned just a little bit earlier was this Dura-Walkie. And the DuraWalkie handset, like I said, was a two-way radio only handset. And what that means is that our full-featured handsets offer this long-range telephone, but they also have a built-in digital two-way radio into the handset. That digital two-way radio allows you to do broadcast a message, like push to talk, broadcast a message to the other handsets, or do an intercom call between two handsets, full duplex, you know, talk and listen at the same time, and have that ability to have that private, so it isn't being broadcast to all the other handsets, a private conversation, even if outside the range of the base. And the visualization I like to plant in your brain is if I was a school teacher and I was taking some kids on a field trip to a museum well outside the range of the base that's at the school, and I have another teacher with me, and we split up and we each take, you know, 10 kids, and then I can two-way radio the other handset at the museum. Both handsets must be at the museum, I should say that, within range of each other. And I can say, hey, you know, why don't we meet for lunch in 15 minutes? Then the other person can start gathering up the kids and, you know, acknowledge that and say, yeah, we'll meet you down at the cafeteria. So that is really, really powerful to be able to take these away from the system and still have that communication between each other. And certainly in environments where, you know, hey, power may go down, so the base is down, but I can still communicate between handsets and coordinate things, whether that's at a senior living place and get people out due to a fire or a tornado or, you know, whatever it may be, I can still have that communication. So that is a really, really neat feature. So the DuraWalkie handsets can do all of that broadcast, that intercom capability. They just can't make phone calls. The neat thing that distinguishes us from other two-way radios out on the market is that I can actually take a full-featured handset, a Duraphone Pro, for instance, handset, and take a call on that handset and transfer it to a DuraWalkie. So if the person carrying only a DuraWalkie handset is best able to help whoever the caller is, I can transfer the call over to the DuraWalkie handset, and they can assist the resident or the customer, whoever it may be, with whatever concerns there are. And then as soon as they hang up, they no longer have phone line access. So that is a really, really cool feature. The second handset I wanted to bring up that's part of the Duraphone Pro system is the Duraphone UHF handset. And the UHF handset is a full-featured handset, does everything the Duraphone Pro handset, but it has a neat little thing included with it. It has a second radio. The second radio works on the UHF frequency. It's like 460 megahertz instead of 900, right? It has that 900 megahertz frequency as well, but it has this UHF frequency in there. And that allows you to communicate with third-party analog UHF radios from Motorola, Kenwood, whoever it may be. If they're analog UHF radios using that UHF frequency, obviously, you can use this handset, do everything the Pro handset can do, have long-range telephone communications on 900 megahertz. It actually still has the digital two-way radio on 900 megahertz built in, and it also has this second radio that allows you to communicate with these third-party UHF radios. So that is a really, really cool feature, and that is available in our USL, which is a single-line model, or it can be added to any of the Pro bases. So a really cool thing if you're using third-party radios. All right, there is a great tool that is on our website that if you, you know, are thinking, oh, okay, you know, would this product make sense for me in a senior living environment? Well, we have case studies, and we have them in all sorts of different environments. So from senior living to retail stores and grocery stores to manufacturing plants, all sorts of different environments, and all sorts of different models, from single line models to multi-line models to SIP models to the freestyles in there, you know, all sorts of stuff. So, you know, go on to our website, go look for, you know, case studies. These pages will come up. We have it both for our data side, our networking side, as well as our voice side. And you can filter by that and say, hey, I just want to look at phones, and then I want to look at things for senior living or assisted living. You can filter all that out and get right down to things that apply to what you're looking for. But they are a great thing. They talk about, you know, what was the considerations when people were looking at Ingenious as a solution? Were they, you know, what was their struggles? What was their pain points? And what had they tried? And what did they, you know, like and hate about their present solution? And, you know, it goes through a really nice overview so that you can, you know, kind of relate to, yeah, we suffer from that. So how do I get this resolved? And you can see how this these products were a solution to them. So definitely one of the greatest tools from my point of view on the website is case studies. So take a look at that. We're going to go into some of the difference makers. These difference makers are products we offer that help resolve difficult problems and things that you may not think, oh, would they ever offer something like that? Chances are we do, and I want you to be aware of it. So that's why we put it in here. And so we're going to spend a few minutes here to go through some of these things. And I am going to pick Gabe's brain on a lot of these. So you'll be hearing a lot more from Gabe as we go through here. Okay, Gabe. First thing we have here is an outdoor external antenna. So why would I ever need this, and what does it do?
Sure. So an outdoor one, maybe if you want outdoor coverage, like I want to cover a parking lot, I'll do an outdoor antenna. But if I want to do inside like a warehouse, let's say there is a, we've actually had this in real life. Let's say there is a wall between the warehouse because they merge two warehouses together. And the attenuation going through the wall is maybe like, let's say 15 dB, which is a lot. If I were to put the antenna above the wall, then my attenuation is maybe 2 to 3 dB. So even though I have this wall here, I'm still able to get coverage beyond the wall because I'm going over the wall instead of through it, okay. So above obstacles.
And so with something like a firewall that goes floor to ceiling, are you suggesting I could potentially put this on top of the roof and penetrate down, or what are you suggesting?
Yeah, sometimes it's better to put it on a roof and then you only have that much penetration to go through as opposed to an obstacle which is higher attenuating. Okay. So we've seen that before where you actually want to deploy something, even though it's an indoor type of use, they want to deploy the antennas outside so they get the better range, better okay. coverage.
And so being an outdoor antenna, and if I were a school, I could have, you know, coverage inside as well as the playground area. Mm-hmm. Or if I were an assisted living, I have a little grounds, you know, a little park kind of setting. I could have coverage out there as well with having an outdoor antenna. So that's really a neat thing. And this, how does this antenna work with our system? How does it attach to the system? How does it become part of it?
Sure. In the image, you could see there is, in this case, 20 meters of LMR 400 cable. The N-type connector is a reverse thread N, and then the one that goes to the base is the reverse thread T and C. It's very kind of, you can hard tell. You could tell the one on the left-hand side is the N because it's thicker, and the one on the right-hand side is the T and C. It's a smaller diameter type connector. And they're reverse thread, so it's reverse of what you normally would expect.
Yeah, and I know that we have to give people a warning with the reverse thread. What would that warning be about taking off the antenna on the base?
Well, don't use a wrench.
Don't use a wrench.
And instead of righty-tighty, lefty-loosey, it's righty-loosey, lefty-tighty.
Right. You say that better than I can. If you are thinking about doing an external antenna, be sure when you're about to remove any of our antennas on any of our bases, they are reverse thread. So be sure that whoever's doing that knows that it's not just really on there too tight and they go and run and get the wrench. You don't want that because you will bust that antenna connector right off the base and that becomes an expensive repair. What you want to do is just hand loosen it, but you got to go the opposite direction. And when you go to put this one on, don't use a wrench either. Just hand tighten the coax on there. So keep that in mind. We see too many of these where somebody thought it was stuck just because it was going in the wrong direction that they anticipated. So why do we have reverse thread? Well, this is an FCC requirement. Because of our coverage, our power that we put out, they want to be sure that everything is controlled. So it uses an antenna that's been approved for them with this power and that radiating power of the antenna. But this is what's given us our coverage. So, it's a nice thing that the FCC is allowing us to use antennas, but they want to be sure it's these antennas and not some other crazy antenna. You're still unlicensed, remember, so you don't require a FCC license to use this product with the asterisk next to the UHF, that is a license band. But all the other product is unlicensed, and that's why we have these reverse thread antennas. All right, let's go into a needed accessory if you're any place that gets weather. If you have thunderstorms, build up of static charges in your environment. We're here in Southern California, so it's less active as places like Florida may be. if that's a concern where you don't want static charges building up on an outdoor antenna, then you may want to consider a lightning protection kit. This is a static surge protector. And what it does, it protects the base from that static charge from running down that coax and damaging the components in the base unit. Because again, an expensive repair. So what you want to do is put something to redirect that static charge to ground. And that's what this does. So it's a gas fuse. It gets placed between the antenna coax and another piece of coax that's going to the base. And then you have a wire, depending on your local codes, a ground wire that's going to ground to a grounding rod, grounding plate, whatever is required for your environment or your area. And that gas fuse will trigger, send that static discharge to ground instead of damaging the base. And let me tell you a little bit about the gas fuse. The gas fuse is good for about 300 discharges. So in an active area, this is probably going to last for about a year, maybe 2 years, depending on how active that area is. So you want to change out that fuse about once a year, once every other year. So just like your smoke detectors, where you're changing out the batteries once a year, do the same with your gas fuse. You can't look at the fuse and see that it's blown, so you just have to remember to change those out especially if you're in those areas that are static discharge, or that have thunderstorms for build up of static discharge. That benefit to this is that if your base is damaged by a static discharge and you have a lightning protection and your product is still under factory warranty, we will cover it under factory warranty. If you don't have one and a base is damaged due to a static discharge, even though it's still under factory warranty, that damage is not covered. So definitely well worth a few dollars for a lightning protection kit. All right, let's go inside where we don't have to worry about it. Gabe, what can you tell us about this antenna?
Sure. So this antenna was designed to be in drop ceilings, as you could see in the image. So if you wanted to put the extra antenna indoors, you would have to mount it right side up, not upside down. And that would mean you'd have to put it up in the tiles to try to hide it. This brings it below the tiles, so you get less attenuation between the handset and the antenna. Just like if I were to install speakers, I wouldn't install them above the ceiling tiles, right? Where no one could hear them, I would install them below. So this gives you the ability to put the antenna inside below the ceiling tiles. Why would you do this? Let's say we have a telecom closet next to the elevator, and that's not the best place to be putting this base issue for the antenna. So you want to move it closer to the users. And then what you could do is you could use this antenna with the cable and just move it closer to the users and have the base station over there in the telecom closet.
Okay, that makes sense. So designed for indoor use, not outdoor use. It still has that reverse thread connector and cable and all that, correct?
Yes.
And this is great for indoor coverage, and it's really been designed for that. So it's going to give you even better performance than putting up the outdoor antenna inside, just because of how it's designed. And so that pattern is going to give you better coverage in these kind of environments where you're just kind of spreading out on a single level or a couple levels. Keep this one in mind. Remember, these are just cordless phones, and yet we're offering these antennas and lightning protection kits, and we're going to go into more. I want to take a moment here as we're going into the last few slides to remind you to go ahead and put any questions that you have into the question and answer tab, and we'll try to answer those at the end of it. If you have, comments or anything like that, throw it in there. And we read all of those, even if we don't get a chance to answer these. But I definitely want to take a minute to remind you to use that tab. All right, what the heck is this funky device?
So that's an antenna splitter. So if I wanted to do a situation like here, image where I wanted to maybe put one on one floor, internal antenna on one floor, internal another floor, I'll do that. I could also do it where if I want to do outdoor indoor coverage, one going to an outdoor antenna, one going to an indoor antenna. So the flexibility of the splitter is good. Now, one thing to note is that a lot of people ask this question. It's you could have multiple antennas going to one base station. It's not the reverse where you have one antenna serving multiple bases from here.
Okay, so it is. The direction as pictured is correct, where the two connectors go to two antennas, and the one connector goes to the base. These are also reverse thread, so keep that in mind. Can I have an outdoor antenna and an indoor? I'm showing two indoor. Can I mix and match like that, or do I have to stay consistent?
You can mix and match.
Okay. So if you recall, when Gabe was saying that you could put an outdoor antenna up on the roof and get coverage, for the outside. You can also drop an indoor antenna in here and have coverage on the inside. The way I think of it is like an auto dealership, where I have a showroom and I need coverage inside there. That's where the offices are. You know, I have a couple of cars in there, but the vast majority of my product, my cars, are out on the lot, right? So I have an outdoor antenna that's taking care of the lot, indoor antenna taking care of the offices. So that gives me that flexibility of doing both ways. I can go up and down floors, like Gabe had mentioned, I can also go around obstacles. Like if I had a hallway going one way and a hallway going another way in like an L shape, I could use two antennas, run them down both of those hallways, and now I've covered both hallways instead of trying to fight through a corner and a bunch of offices and another bunch of offices. Now I can just go around those obstacles and get the coverage. So these are great, great solutions to making sure that you get the maximum amount of coverage off any of these base units and handsets. Okay, what you're looking at are some display screens from our handset, but it's tied to a really cool tool that we probably talk about with the customers every single day about how did the RSSI tool go. So Gabe, what the heck is RSSI? Why is it a tool?
I guess it depends upon who you're asked for. It can mean receive signal strength indicator, or it could also mean, I like to call it a relative signal strength indicator. So basically, not just signal strength alone, but some other metrics as well. In our case, it's also BRRR included in with RSSI. It calculates out what the signal quality is along with the signal strength, and it gives you a readout. And so without even hooking up the base station to a telephone and running and trying to make calls, like the guy from the old call from Verizon, numbers, can you hear me now? We could just have access to power that base station, then you could run this RSSI tool and determine whether that's the proper location for the base.
Okay. So in looking at this, the readings on the RSSI tool, let me start. The tool's included with all the handsets.
Yes.
It's free to use. So you definitely want to take advantage of this. The readings on the RSSI tool are a negative number. So what's good? A big negative number or a little negative number? Am I trying to get closer to zero or closer to a million?
So the reason why it's a negative number is it's when I start, when I oscillate, the greatest loss of energy would be the transferring from the electrical out into the electromagnetic. And so that power output would be a lot less. So instead of trying to say a very large number, like 0.00001 watt or milliwatt, we just have a system where we just say, okay, negative 30 dB or something, and you could know what that is. And so it makes it easier to work with very large, small numbers, if that makes sense. The scale is the closer to zero, the stronger the signal, the further from zero, the weaker the signal.
Okay. And so the reason you're using this tool is so that you can find the best location for the base unit when you're first setting up the equipment. So you have a base, you have a handset, you don't even need to have phone lines plugged in. Just power to the base, obviously a powered handset. And then you can place the base someplace where you think, oh, this might be a good spot. Take a floor plan with you, run around, take these readings, make notes on the floor plan, and say, gosh, it seemed like I had a really negative number over here, so bad signal. Maybe if I move the base a little bit this way or around this obstacle, I can improve that. And so you move the base a little bit, and then you take these readings again, and you say, oh, that did it. This is a better area to have this base. And then you can worry about, okay, now I need to bring phone lines here and mount this base up. But then you're gonna be done with it, and you've got the best coverage for that base for your users, for your handsets. So it's a really, really powerful tool. And like I said, probably daily, when we are speaking to people as they're deploying our systems, we ask them to do the RSSI test and, you know, let us know, hey, what were those readings? Where did you find, you know, good and bad? You know, can we look at this floor plan and identify, oh, well, that has a kitchen. It's trying to go through a lot of metal, or a x-ray room with lead-lined walls, you know, all sorts of things that cause interference. And so you try to work a way around that. And this makes it a visual thing of, oh, as soon as I turn that corner, signal dropped. Great, how do we do it? Is it putting up antennas? Is it coming down from the roof? You know, what is it? And it may be, hey, as soon as I went outside into the playground, the school scenario, I drop. Well, yeah, an outdoor antenna may resolve that. Maybe it's a splitter, indoor antenna, outdoor antenna. So lots of ways to get and improve this, but having this reading and numeric value, you can see that, yeah, I'm really bad, or I'm just marginally weak in that area, or I've got a really, really strong signal here. So great tool to have. It's included with the handsets. Instructions are on the website. Definitely take advantage of this if you're deploying any of our systems. That ends the presentation. Like I said, we're gonna hang out here for a couple minutes to answer some questions. So if you haven't had a chance, now's a good time to go into the question and answer, and we will start to answer some questions here. And I want to make sure I have all this on. Okay. All right. So Gabe, they want to have a question about the Duraphone SIP. And if I had multiple SIP bases, first off, is the Duraphone SIP a multi-base system?
No, it's a single base system, so you can't base link.
So the risk here is if I had a second Duraphone SIP base, that I would interfere with each other. And I wouldn't be able to two-way radio handsets on one base to handsets on another. Completely different families. So unlike the Duraphone Pro, PSL, USL, those models, where I can add multiple bases, keep that family, no matter whether I have one base or eight bases. All those handsets can two-way and broadcast and intercom with each other. And, you know, I can share that and I won't interfere because they recognize each other. So that's kind of the benefit to the Analog Pro stuff that is currently a struggle with the Duraphone SIP. But the Duraphone SIP is a great model if you have, you know, 10 users, something like that, where you can share those four talk paths, each have your own extension, does require SIP accounts for those handsets, those 10 handsets, if you will. And then they can still have long range, still have two-way radio and all that among those 10. But it is not a multi-base system.
Yeah, the only workaround we have is to make calls to the secondary SIP system through your PBX. But you won't have broadcast or two-way sharing of those handsets on those two separate systems.
You know, that is a great point that Gabe brought up, and we use it a lot, even with the Duraphone Pro. The two-way radio aspect, if you will, recenters the location of the signal, right? And what I mean by that is if you have a base in the best area because you did the RSSI, and it's, let's say, central to your environment, it's putting out this area, this circle, around that center point where the base is located. And handsets within any of those things can make and receive calls from that base in that environment. But now picture I'm trying to do a broadcast or an intercom call, and just to simplify things, we'll talk about an intercom call. So I've got one handset on the far side of the building, one handset on the near side of the building, and they're both equal distance from the base. So they both can make and receive phone calls, no problem. But they try to two-way radio each other. If this environment was over, or let's say within 250,000 square feet, you know, something we should be able to do with the phone side. So that 250,000 square feet, remember, is a radius on either side. So if I'm trying to reach that other handset. I'm going handset to handset. I'm not going through the base. So I'm only going to get halfway there if I'm, you know, maxed out, right? Mm-hmm. I'm only going to get halfway there. I can reach the base, but I can't reach the other handset. So to resolve that issue, if they're trying to do a communication between handsets, is just what Gabe mentioned. I can go from one handset, call to the base to an extension on the PBX that the other handset is tied to, just like I'd call someone's desk. So I call that other extension, they pick up, even though handset to handset wise, I'm past the coverage area because I've recentered that position. And now I'm using the base to make communication between those handsets. So that's a really, really neat trick to maximize your coverage for really large environments. So you get both either way.
Definitely.
So let's see if we had any other questions here. Well, that looks like it was it. So I want to thank everybody. If you do think, if you're like me, and as soon as you hang up, you start to think of things, feel free to email us. You know, you can drop us a note. Happy to answer those and ask your questions. If you have something where you're a senior living place and you want to have some questions you want to talk about privately, we're here for you. We're happy to do that. If you're one of our resellers or distributors, one of our channel partners, and you have some clients that you're thinking of trying to help, and you have specific questions, maybe not even on the Durafone Pro or whatever, again, we're here to help you. Feel free to give us a call, and we'll walk you through that and make it the best recommendation we can. All right, everyone, I really want to thank you all for joining us today. I want to thank you, Gabe, for joining me. I really appreciate that. And I hope everyone has a great rest of the week. And we will do this again next month if you want to join us for another presentation. Take care now.